Jnanam Paramam Dheyam. Knowledge is supreme.
So once you have the notion of perpendicularity, you can talk about orthogonal sets. A set of vectors in an inner product space, we will call it as orthogonal if any two of them are perpendicular to each other, right? Dot product is equal to 0. Whatever be the definition of dot product, once there is a dot product, right, we can define perpendicularity with respect to that dot product. Okay? And we will say it is orthonormal if each vector has got length 1, right, like in finite dimensional spaces. Okay. So, here is same theorem works here also, which same proof works that if a set of vectors is orthogonal, then it is also linearly independent. Same proof which was there earlier, no change at all, right. So, we will not go to the proof again. So, same proof works. Now, let us look at a particular case, because you mentioned sine and cos, this is nice here. Look at space of continuous functions from minus pi to pi. So, a is minus pi, b is pi. Okay. And so, what will be the dot product? Minus pi to pi f t g t d t, right? It's okay? Right. On this, let us look at this set. So, what is the set I am looking at? Constant function 1, function cos x with domain as minus pi to pi, sin x, cos 2 x, sin 2 x, and so on, cos n x, sin n x. So, one class of functions is cos n x, n 1, 2, 3 for so on, and similarly sin n x and the constant function 1. So, this collection of functions is a orthogonal set with respect to this inner product. Why is that orthogonal? What is the integral of cos x between minus pi to pi? What is the integral of cos x? It is a periodic function, right? 0, right. What is the, and if you take cos square, right, dot product you want to take. So, what is the norm of this? Norm will be integral of cos square. So, that will not be 0. That will be integral minus pi to pi of cos square theta, right. But if you look at cos and sin, the product, and integrate between minus pi to pi, what is that integral? Check out, that is 0, right. And similarly, when you say integral of cos x is 0, so that is 1 times cos x, integral is 0. That means what? 1 and cos x are perpendicular to each other. Similarly, cos x is perpendicular to sin x, right. So, all, so if you can easily check, when n is not equal to m, cos n x into sin n x, right, integral is equal to 0. So, any two of them are orthogonal to each other, and integral of mod of this square is not equal to 0. Right. So, this set is an orthogonal set in the space of continuous functions. This is an orthogonal set. Why it orthogonal? Dot product of any two of them is 0. That means what? So, that means integral of, take one function, take another function, that integral of the product is equal to 0. So, what will be the function look like? Is it cos n x, sin n x, right? Or sin n x and to sin m, n and m are different, even then the integral is equal to 0 if n is not equal to m, right. So, this is a orthogonal set and I can make it orthonormal. So, how to make it orthonormal? By dividing by the norm of each one of them, and integral of each one of them comes out to be equal to pi. So, that is, so this gives you a orthonormal set in C01. Okay, just checking, nothing more than that. And this is a very important orthonormal set. When you do some, I think Already if you have done something in differential equations or partial differential equations, there will come something called Fourier series, right. So there what you do, what is Fourier series? That is expanding a function in terms of cos and sine. These are precisely the basis you can think of. This is the orthogonal set in terms of which you try to expand every function, right. So this will come back to you in the when you study Fourier series problem. Okay. So it is important there. So important thing is this is a orthonormal set. Okay. And this is an infinite orthonormal set. The any two of them are perpendicular to each other. So this is also a any two which are mutually orthogonal, also linearly independent. So this is also a linearly independent set in particular in the space C minus pi to pi. So that is an infinite dimensional vector space on which there is an inner product, and there is a notion, there is example of a infinite orthonormal set. Okay, right. Now, if you recall, we had done in a finite dimensional vector space, given a basis, you can make an orthonormal basis out of it. Right. So, what was the process of converting a basis to an orthonormal basis? That was basically using what is called the Gram-Schmidt process. Right. So, at every stage, remove the projection of on the previously defined. So, I am just recalling. So, given vectors, okay, any finite number of vectors. See, this set may be finite or infinite, but look at V1, right? If that is non-zero, so define W1 to be equal to V1. So, what is W2? So, inductive process. I am describing Gram-Schmidt process again. From W2, what is W2? Remove the projection of W1 onto V2. So, this projection you remove. So, this will be perpendicular, W1 and W2 will be perpendicular. What is W3? From V3, the next one, remove the projection on the previously defined vectors, okay, the Gram-Schmidt process. So, if you go on doing that process up to any k, you can remove the previous projection. So, what you will get? You will get vectors W1, W2, Wk, which are mutually orthogonal, and the space spanned by them is same as the space spanned by W1, W2 up to V1, V2 up to Vk, right? For finite dimensional, that is what we have done. The same process we can carry over if there is a sequence of if there is a say infinite set. But the problem is you can carry on given any n minus 1 having defined, you can define the next one. Okay. So we will get for any k, you will get an orthonormal set which will span the same thing. But I cannot say that if I define for all W1, W, Wn, their space spanned by will be same as V1, V2, Vk. I do not know that. You understand what I am saying? Given an infinite sequence up to finite stage, you can apply Gram-Schmidt process. You will get a W1. Space spanned by V1, V2, Vk is same as space spanned by this. But I cannot say space spanned by all of V1, V2, V infinity will be same as W1s. We do not have a process of saying that. Right, up to any finite stage is okay. So, what was the advantage of the Gram-Schmidt process? It gave you a way of finding orthonormal basis for a finite dimensional vector space. Start with a basis, convert it into a orthonormal basis. So, you can say for a finite dimensional vector space, right, every finite dimensional inner product space has got a orthonormal basis, because there will be some basis and I can convert that into orthonormal. But is it same theorem true for infinite dimension? Can I say that for an infinite dimensional inner product space, there is a orthonormal basis? That is a difficult question to answer, right? And is that leads to something called the study of spaces called Hilbert spaces. So, we will not go into that. Okay. Will not bother about that. Those of you who go on to take some minor courses later on in mathematics, in something called finite element methods or such things, you will find this coming there. So this subject, this leads to a subject called study of topic called functional analysis. So, CAB is a function space, right? Space of functions. So, what space of functions as a vector space has got a basis, notion of a magnitude and notion of an angle and existence of orthonormal basis. So, such things fall under the study of a subject called functional analysis. So, if you happen to take that, this will be a starting point for there. Okay. So, we will not go into that because that requires a lot of more machinery to understand. Okay. So, let us do one example, the same one we have been doing. So, let us take C of minus 1 to 1, right? That is a vector space and this is the inner product on that. And we had orthonormal basis, we had the linearly independent set 1, x, x square and so on. Remember, for any space of polynomials, right, 1, x, x square up to x to the power n is an independent set. So, if I take this infinite sequence, any finite number of them is linearly independent. So, I can ask, apply the Gram-Schmidt process to it, this set. So, what will be u 1? That vector is same as v 1, okay, that is a constant function 1. So, this 1, okay. Because first one is v 1 equal to w 1, right, first one as it is. So, what is the next one? U 2, from v 2 remove the projection, right. So, what is the dot product here? What is v 1 and v 2? V 2 v 1, sorry, v 2 u 1, that is the integral of v 2 u 1 dx, right, minus 1 to 1, and this is a norm into u. So, if you compute that, that comes out to be half of integral minus 1 to 1 dt, okay. And that, right, that integral you can compute, that is obvious. So, this is equal to x. This part is 0, right? Is it okay? This integral is 0, minus 1 to 1, the function is odd t, okay. So, that is 0, so it is x. So, u 1 is equal to 1, u 2 equal to x. So, the first two are perpendicular to each other. Gram-Schmidt does not give you anything new. Let us look at the next one, x square, what happens. So, what will be the next one, u 3? From u 3, you have to remove the projections, right, on u 1 and u 2 from v 3, that is x square. So, let us do that. So, x square, remove the projection onto 1, remove the projection onto x and write everything in terms of the dot product, that is the integrals. So, those are the integrals and you simplify, that comes out to be x square minus 1 by 3. So, the Gram-Schmidt process gives you u 3 to be equal to, from x square you have to remove minus 1 by 3, then u 1, u 2, u 3 are perpendicular to each other. And you can go on doing this process further, more examples, more integrals to be computed. So, and then, but these are not orthonormal, we have to orthonormalize them, right. They are orthogonal only. So, you can divide by the norm, normalize them. So, w 1 will be u 1 by this. So, that is equal to this u 2, okay, by the norm of that. So, that is square root 3 by 2 and similarly u 3 is equal to this. Right, just dividing by the integral of mod square, normalize these w. So, what we are doing is, we are starting with that polynomials 1, x, x square, x cube and so on, and Gram-Schmidt process, we are orthonormalizing them. You get another set of polynomials. Those polynomials are perpendicular to each other and has got norm equal to 1. They are very special polynomials, they will come back to you sometime. Again, in differential equations, most probably called Legendre polynomials. So, this is the construction of Legendre polynomials, how they are constructed. You take the standard polynomials 1, x, x square, x cube and so on and apply Gram-Schmidt process and orthonormalize them, right. So, that is useful there. Now, you can prove Bessel's inequality, but that is same as one we did for finite dimensional spaces, because that is only valid for 1 to k, right. But you can generalize this, okay. So, let us keep it for finite only. So, finite same proof works, only thing is there is a notion of dot product now. So, same properties you can use and prove Bessel's inequality. So, basically what we are saying is you can extend the notion of inner product from on any vector space. So, what is the definition taken? The definition is you take the properties of the dot product in Rn and transport it as a definition on any vector space, right. So, that is one. So, it once there is a notion of dot product, it gives you a notion of perpendicularity. Once there is a notion of perpendicularity, you can talk about orthonormalization process, Gram-Schmidt process, but that works only for finite number of them. That does not work for any induction. You can stop, go up to any stage, any n, but you cannot just say that we will get a sequence w1, w2, wn dot dot dot, infinite sequence you will get. That will be orthogonal also, right. Any finite number of any two of them are perpendicular to each other, but whether the space spanned by this is same as the space spanned by up to finite is okay. V1, V2, Vn and W1, W2, Wn will give you the same vector space, span will be same, but all of them infinite sequence will give you the same space. That is not true actually, you need something more, okay. So, that is a study of other space. Now, I think I'll just probably say something. What we did, we do in finite dimensional spaces, we looked at what are called maps which were isometries. Once there was a notion of inner product, you can define the notion of an isometry, right. What is isometry? If you take V and W, T is a map between two vector spaces or inner product spaces, then that if you take inner product of V and W, that is same as the inner product of TV and TW, right. So, they preserve the notion of angles and distances. Same you can define for infinite dimensional kind of things, but analysis of them becomes much more difficult. For finite dimension, we proved what is called the spectral theorem, right. Corresponding thing is true, but one has to do a lot of work, and that again goes to the dimension space of goes to the field of functional analysis. You look at what are called orthogonal transformations between vector spaces and so on. So, again I am just saying this is a beginning of another topic called functional analysis, right. So, which some of you will come across probably. So, we will stop here with the course, okay, nothing more in the course, because all mostly we are dealt with finite dimensional spaces only, right, and their properties. So, with that we end the course.